So welcome. It's great to be here. I have some notes that I'll be reading from tonight. So for the structure for tonight, I'll just give a brief introduction, looking at some notes. A little bit on myself, since probably most of you don't know anything about me, just 30 seconds or something. And then talk briefly about Nagarjuna, the author of the text we'll be looking at tonight, and the Ratnavali itself, briefly about that text, and about the topic of ethics in brief. And then I'll move on to various verses we'll be looking at. I have made my own notes, and I'll be reading actually, as Bob did the other night, from the Avatamsaka, the Garland Sutra. I'll actually just be reading a good number of verses so you get a flavor of the text, and pointing out different themes and giving my own commentary on some of those verses as need be. And hopefully we'll have a good amount of time at the end for questions and answer and discussion as well. So also, just to give you a heads up, I'll also be giving another talk in this series on April 20th that will be of interest on Nalanda University, which, as you may know, was a university, a Buddhist-run university in India in the first millennium, basically, from which pretty much the entire Indo-Tibetan Buddhist system derives. It was an amazing university system in which not only Buddhist texts and practices were studied and practiced, but texts, arts and sciences from all the different traditions in India at the time, including secular arts and sciences. So it really was like what we would consider a secular university today. So I'll be giving a talk on that on April 20th, which will fill in more of the historical background as to where some of these kinds of texts we've been discussing came from. And Paul Hackett will be joining me on that night to discuss the Tibetan side of that. In other words, once it's transmitted into Tibet, how the Tibetans pick up that university educational system and modify it and make their own curriculum based on that. So just to let you know, on April 20th, I'll be back again on April 27th with Bob to talk about tantric theory and practice. And in a separate series, if you're interested, I'll be giving a four-part series on Buddhist ethics. So if you're interested in what we covered tonight, we'll be expounding upon that quite a bit more. And that'll be on April 5th, 7th, 12th, and 14th. That's a series being co-hosted by Tibet House and Jewel Heart. So there'll be two classes here, I think on the Tuesday nights here, and two classes over at Jewel Heart. So we'll be discussing Buddhist ethics in much more depth. Tonight we'll be looking really just at Buddhist ethics through the lens of one particular text, Nagarjuna's Jewel Rosary Ratnavali. So in brief, Nagarjuna, I'm going to guess that probably many of you know who Nagarjuna is, including those of you out in TV land, but some people may not know. So I'm just going to give a quick summary overview of Nagarjuna and of the Ratnavali itself. Nagarjuna was an Indian philosopher about the 1st to 2nd century CE, who was actually prophesied by the Buddha in four different sutras: the Journey to Lanka, or the Lankavatara Sutra, the Great Cloud Sutra, the Great Drum Sutra, and the Manjushri Root Tantra. And he was actually prophesied as somebody who would come about 500 years after the time of Shakyamuni Buddha, it was 500 BC, who would essentially reveal into the public eye universal form of Buddhism, what's Mahayana Buddhism. So Mahayana texts and practices themselves were believed to have been present in India from the time of Shakyamuni Buddha, but not really publicly manifested. Nagarjuna does two things. He publicly brings these sutras into view, in particular the Prajnaparamita, or the Perfection of Wisdom Sutra, which becomes extremely important for all forms of Mahayana Buddhism moving forward throughout Asia. And he also writes his own commentaries on various sutras in the collection that eventually gets translated from Sanskrit into Tibetan, what's called the Tengir. There's about 158 texts ascribed to Nagarjuna, so he was a very prolific author. Maybe made a little bit easier by the fact that he was said to have lived for about 600 years, so a little extra time to write texts. So one of the texts that Nagarjuna wrote is the text we'll be looking at tonight. He was also considered, importantly, one of the two founders of one of two sort of, they're not really lineages, but they're sort of forms or types of Buddhist understanding. There's what's called the sort of the profound lineage. Bob Thurman mentioned this briefly when he was talking about the Avatamsaka Sutra. There's the profound side, which sort of emanates really from Manjushri, the Bodhisattva wisdom. These are sutras or teachings that really tend to emphasize more the analytical and deconstructive approach, really emphasizing the fact that everything is empty. And then the magnificent side, which is sort of the full side of emptiness, where you get the kinds of great readings we had in the Garland Sutra the other night, this very, very full, lavish, descriptions of Buddha fields, of jewels, of bodhisattvas, and so forth. So Nagarjuna is considered sort of the primary human figure descending from Manjushri, the bodhisattva wisdom, who promulgates, writes more about the profound side. One of his most famous texts, some of you will know, is this text, the Mula Madhyamaka Karikas, or the Fundamental Treatise on the Middle Way. If you're going to study Madhyamaka philosophy, Buddhist philosophy, this is the most important text that you sort of work your way up to. You don't start here necessarily, but this is where you end up, either in a Tibetan tradition or in any of the Indian traditions, and indeed many of the East Asian traditions. This is an incredible, very analytical text, very interesting to study in a Western setting. We compare his thought very much to contemporary deconstructive thought. Philosophers of language like Wittgenstein and Derrida are oftentimes compared to Nagarjuna's, this particular text. So that's a very important text. On the other side, the magnificent side, the sort of the patron Buddha or Bodhisattva would be Maitreya, and the human figure on that side would be Asanga, who tends to promulgate and write about and reveal that side. These aren't irreconcilable visions. They're very, very much reconcilable, in fact, but they can emphasize either the empty side or the full side of the Buddhist view of reality. Okay, so then the Ratnavali itself, the jewel garland, is translated in English. It looks like this: Buddhist Advice to Living and Liberation is the English title that Jeffrey Hopkins gave it when he translated it. We'll talk about that title a little bit. He wrote this text as a letter, actually, to a Shatavahana king, either Gautamiputra or Udayi, depending on which historians you listen to. So this is an unusual text in the sense that it's in five chapters, 100 verses per chapter, so 500 verses total. And it's actually a letter of advice to a king who was a friend of his. Nagarjuna was not only a great philosopher and revealer of texts and commentator, he was also famous as being a very gifted alchemist, a very gifted doctor. He wrote a lot about this. He practiced medicine. He was invited to royal courts. In fact, a lot of Buddhism spread throughout Asia because of its knowledge of an implementation of medicine. So Nagarjuna was key in that as well. It's not that uncommon for great figures in Buddhist history to ally themselves with various kings and give them advice and so forth. So this particular text is one of a few where he's actually writing to a king, although as we'll see towards the end of the text, he mentions that although this is advice being given to a king, it's actually advice that's relevant to anybody, whether they're a ruler of any sort or not, really anybody interested in practicing the Mahayana. But that's the context of this book, as we'll see. And in terms of its content or topics that it covers, it also covers very much this profound side, the analytic side, Madhyamaka philosophy. Deconstructive arguments are laid forth for taking apart things, showing that things are constructs and so forth, but not nearly as in-depth as in the other book that we looked at a minute ago. There's arguments made, but this book covers not only that, but also discusses ethics quite a bit, which is why that'll be a primary topic for tonight. And he shows the relationship between the two. And he actually talks about ethics in a way that will be relevant, very relevant to this force for good theme, because he talks about ethics in a way that can be taken up certainly by Buddhists, by those who have a Buddhist worldview, but also anybody who's not necessarily interested in doing Buddhist practice, somebody's coming from a more secular point of view. There's a lot of secular ethics discussed in here as well. And the kind of thinking that comes out in this text is actually the kind of thinking that the Dalai Lama picks up on in his book, Ethics for the New Millennium, which is a book, if you haven't read, I highly recommend. It would be very relevant to this course. Ethics for the New Millennium, the Dalai Lama wrote in the year 2000 as an attempt to say, here's my experience with ethics. Here's what I would like to offer to the world in terms of a rationale for ethics that could be applicable to anybody, whether they are a Buddhist or practicing a different religious tradition or even secular. So he puts forth a very compelling argument for why ethics is important and has a place in our global society from any point of view. So it's sort of a secularized version of ethics. A lot of his thinking is coming from this book as well as the broader tradition, of course, but this book in particular. This book in particular is also, along with Shantideva's book, which probably many of you are familiar with, Shantideva's Bodhicharya Avatar, or Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life. It's been published with different covers. There's been a lot of translations of this done. This is Bachelor's. But there's probably been 6, 8, 10 different translations done by now. This book is considered sort of the handbook for Buddhist ethics for bodhisattvas in the Mahayana tradition. And these two books, the Ratnavalipa Nagarjuna and Shantideva's Bodhicharya Avatara, these two books are considered the source of what becomes the Lojong, or the mind training tradition in Tibet. So if you're familiar with that tradition, this book will also be directly relevant. The Lojong, or mind training tradition, there's another book here called Essential Mind Training, which Tupten Jinpa translated. These are actually excerpts from a much larger collection. This is a genre of literature in Tibet that emerged very much inspired by those two books, by Shantideva's book and Nagarjuna's book. And it's a genre which really emphasizes the bodhisattva's need to really, it's sort of like a bodhisattva boot camp. It's really compassion and bodhicitta on steroids. If you read this, if you haven't read this material, it really takes, it's for the practitioner who's really made the commitment to practicing altruism and really to taking on seriously the battle with the ego, the battle with self-cherishing. So whereas the more analytic texts like Nagarjuna's are interested in deconstructing the possibility of a self, so they're deconstructing the self and showing that the self is, the ego is in fact a construct, so he's deconstructing it. Sort of analytically out there, the mind training texts do that more affectively or internally, like what does that feel like when you think you have a separate self and you get attached to it? You have what's called self-cherishing. So on the sort of more analytic philosophical side, you have what's called the I habit, the self-habit. But then on the more affective emotional side, you have the self-cherishing. You're grasping at the self and you have the self-cherishing. So the mind training texts that really take off in Tibet really are represent forms of practice, teachings and practice that help the aspiring bodhisattva battle that ego habit. So again, the Ratnavali text we'll be looking at today is key to that entire tradition in Tibet. Essential mind training, this is a translation by Tupten Jinpa, who's the translator for the Dalai Lama, and who's also a geshe in his own right. He's a Tibetan geshe, also got a PhD at Oxford, now teaches at McGill. Quite an amazing author, has written many, many very important and good books. And this is a collection of translations of Tibetan texts that were written over many centuries by many different authors. Probably the other way around. Some meditation manuals in America might be derived from this, but this is, it's a big question as to what meditation is. I actually teach an entire course on that at Columbia where we look at 10 or 15 different things that get called meditation that are very, very different. So there's analytic meditation like we've been discussing. There's also the kind of meditation people normally think of where you're calming your mind, focusing your mind. That's only one type. There's other types of meditation that have to do with developing, visualizing deities and so forth. Visualizing things with specific goals in mind. And there's other types of meditation that are designed to break down certain addictive habit patterns and to develop positive habit patterns. So the Lojong, or mind training, is that sort of genre. So if you were to find a contemporary text in the Tibetan tradition that the point of which was to inculcate compassion directly and break down the self-ego habit, then yes, it would probably be in that category of mind training. So I'm going to try to go fast now. I'm going to try to cover a lot of ground looking at the text itself. And then at the end of it, we'll stop and have, I hope, plenty of time for questions. I guess the last two overview topics I wanted to cover before we actually look at the text itself is one is looking at ethics in brief, ethics in general terms. I have here at the bottom of this at the top of the page there, ethics in brief. Ethics, as I say, ethics as embedded in the interrelated context of the three higher trainings, Shila, Samadhi, and Prajna. Now, that is, Shila is the Sanskrit word for ethics. Samadhi is one of the many words for meditation, and Prajna is wisdom. It's oftentimes understood that all of Buddhist practice amounts to that, theory and practice, I should say. Everything in Buddhist theory and practice has to do with either ethics or meditation, or wisdom, and wisdom we could, under the term wisdom, we could include philosophy, science, analysis, and so forth. However, I say, as Kyon argues, Kyon, by the way, if you want to read a fantastic book on Buddhist ethics, an overview, I couldn't recommend this more highly. We use this in a course at Columbia. It's called The Nature of Buddhist Ethics. A lot is covered in this book, but one of the things he covers in this book is the fact that even in the Pali tradition, so the pre-Mahayana or Theravada Pali tradition, the breakdown of all of Buddhist practice, the Eightfold Path, breaking it down into these three categories, which the Mahayana also picks up on, actually, he shows very convincingly that within the Buddhist traditions themselves, meditation is actually sort of an adjunct. It's something that empowers. That's why I say here that practice does not equal meditation. Why am I saying that? Because in most Western audiences that I'm used to speaking with, there's the common assumption that Buddhist practice means meditation. They're almost synonymous. If someone asks you, do you practice, it means do you meditate. And in fact, within the Buddhist traditions themselves, nothing could be farther from the truth. It's actually almost the other way around. In other words, and what he shows, what Kyon shows in this book, among other things, it's just one part of his argument, is that within the Pali Sutras, meditation is kind of there as something that empowers the other two, but practice is really ethics and wisdom. That's it. And you may be familiar in the Mahayana, when Mahayana is distilled as much as possible, it distills into two things, wisdom and compassion. Wisdom, of course, is wisdom, and compassion is the Mahayana version of ethics. It's sort of the essence of ethics from a Mahayana point of view. So just as in the Mahayana we can say, in the universal vehicle, we can say Buddhist theory and practice really boils down to wisdom and compassion, even on the Pali side, it's really just ethics and wisdom, that's it. With meditation being something that's an adjunct that helps you focus your mind, it helps you enforce and integrate your ethical practice and your wisdom analysis. It supercharges them. But it's not sort of a separate thing by itself. So that's ethics in brief. And ethics in brief, if you define it, it gets defined different ways in different contexts and different sutras. We'll see some definitions of what we're about to read tonight. But one of the ways in which ethics is defined or described in various Buddhist sutras is ethics, of course, it has to do with behavior between human beings. Therefore, evolutionary behavior, a nice translation for karma, having to do with evolutionary behavior or action. And basically, ethics boils down to not harming others, helping others, and taming or calming your mind or focusing your mind. That's one of the ways in which the Buddha is also quoted as sort of summarizing his entire path, those three things. So the other main topic that's covered throughout, and I'm going to scroll back up here now on the screen to here. Topics arranged with regard to the themes of ascendance and transcendence. These are Thurman's translation for two terms. Throughout this book by Hopkins, he translates those terms, as I put there, high status and definite, I misspelled that, should be definite goodness. And that's translating Sanskrit abhyudaya or Tibetan munto, and then Sanskrit nishreyasa and Tibetan ngelek. And we'll be seeing very clearly what that is as we go through tonight. But in brief, the entire book is arranged around those two themes. And we'll see entire swaths of verses, in other words, that are addressing one or the other of those two themes, sometimes in an integrated way. Sometimes he's pointing out the way in which these are integrated, and sometimes he's talking about the way in which these are two separate things. And what they are in brief is, ascendance is any kind of ethics, the practice of ethics that basically helps you ascend or get to a higher status, improve, you could say, your status within samsara. So this would be secular ethics for sure, because this has nothing to do with the lofty ideal of attaining nirvana or Buddhahood or bodhisattvahood and so forth. So those who are not interested in or not inclined to take on the bodhisattva or even the arhat ideal, the Buddhist paradigm of sort of a spiritual practice with a particular kind of goal in mind, but are interested in being a better husband, a better wife, a better politician, basically working better within the world, then certainly anything to do with ascendant ethics fits into that category. And this also surprises people a lot sometimes because they think that Dharma practice and Dharma ethics has to always have to do with, the goal always has to be becoming a Buddha, right? Becoming a Bodhisattva, a Buddha, an Arhat. It's all at this sort of transcendent level. That is the transcendent side. The transcendent side of that of ethics is that aspect of ethics or those types of ethics where the goal is precisely transcending samsara. Although, as we'll see tonight, and as is very clear throughout the Madhyamaka literature, the transcendence of samsara doesn't mean going somewhere else. There were certain earlier sort of dualistic views of Hinayana or individual vehicle Buddhism that did see nirvana as somehow transcending samsara, this world of addiction, and going somewhere else. You extinguish samsara and you go off to nirvana and you never come back. There were some early Buddhists who sort of thought in those dualistic terms. That was critiqued even within the Hinayana or so-called Hinayana or Theravada traditions, and it was completely critiqued within the Mahayana traditions. So from a Mahayana perspective, the notion of transcendence, this is important, the notion of transcending samsara and therefore attaining nirvana or attaining Buddhahood doesn't mean that you've transcended in the sense of you've gone somewhere else. What it does mean, and again that'll be clear in some of the verses we read tonight, it does mean that you are transforming it. What you're doing is you're seeing through the illusion of samsara and in a sense waking up, which is after all what Buddhahood means. It means to wake up. So, but we'll see both of those layers tonight in what we read tonight. So in the first chapter, I'm just going to go through a number of verses and read them and give some commentary on them as we go. I won't read all these, but I'll be reading a good number of them. So you get a flavor for the beginning. The first seven chapters are his introduction. You can see that I've put ascendance as a category there up through verse 24. So the first 24 verses of the book indeed do address the topic of ascendance, or what Hopkins translates as high status. I'm going to try to substitute in the words ascendance and transcendence if I can do so as I read out loud here. But if I say high status or definite goodness, you'll know I just forgot to substitute it in. So he starts off as follows. Homage to all Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. These are those first seven verses. I bow down to the omniscient, freed from all defects, adorned with all good qualities, the sole friend of all beings. O king, he's addressing the king, I will explain practices solely virtuous to generate in you the doctrine, for the practices will be established in a vessel of the excellent doctrine, vessel being the king. In one who first practices ascendance, transcendence arises later. For having attained, this is going to be hard to do, for having attained ascendance, one comes gradually to transcendence. So he's here in this part saying it's sort of one and then the other. Although as we'll see in other verses, that's sort of a theme that he does emphasize at times, and in other verses he talks about them being simultaneous. And at other times, another question that comes up, which Kyon addresses in his book quite a bit, is do practices like ethics and compassion, are they required all the way up till Buddhahood? Or are they sort of preliminary things you do to clear away certain misbehaviors or misconceptions, at which point you sort of transcend ethics and become transethical, and now wisdom's your focus? Most authors, including Kyon and Nagarjuna, and I would agree with this, are very critical of the notion that ethics is something that's sort of for beginners, that once you've kind of get your house in order, you can forget ethics because now you're working on wisdom, on the good stuff. That's not, and Nagarjuna himself is very critical of that. So there are other verses in here where he makes it clear that ascendant practices like compassion are something that are not only necessary all the way up to the state of Buddhahood, but they're actually constitutive of Buddhahood itself. So a Buddha is an embodiment of compassion, of ethics, as well as wisdom. And in fact, those are the two bodies of the Buddha, the form body and the truth body. But here he's saying sort of in general terms, particularly as you're talking to a beginning practitioner like the king in this case, sort of as step one, you would practice ascendance, and then eventually you would work on transcendent kinds of practices. It does sort of make sense pedagogically in the beginning to present it as a step one, step two process. Ascendance is considered to be happiness. Transcendence is liberation. The quintessence of their means is briefly faith and wisdom, one-to-one correspondence. So due to having faith, one relies on the practices, and due to having wisdom, one truly knows. Of these two, wisdom is the chief, faith is its prerequisite. So he's saying faith does help, and faith is a big topic in Buddhism as well. We won't try to unpack that fully, but it doesn't mean blind faith. What faith means, shraddha, means in Buddhist context, there's three levels of faith. They all have to do with focusing your mind in a certain way, investigating, and really coming to a level of conviction. So if somebody tells you you live on a round earth and you're convinced you live on a flat earth, you're not just supposed to have faith that because somebody else said so, that it's actually a round earth. But what you are supposed to do is investigate, and eventually, when you look at the data, you become convinced, you have some conviction that, in fact, counterintuitively, you actually are living on a spherical Earth, which does seem strange. Once you've come to that point, though, you then have, you could call it faith, or you have some sort of conviction. At some point, of course, if you actually get in a spaceship and go up into outer space, you have direct perceptual knowledge, you could actually call that wisdom. You have knowledge of the fact itself. You perceive it directly. But in order to have that direct knowledge, you wouldn't even get on a spaceship if you didn't at least first investigate the possibility that this could be the case. So faith, in other words, is required, a certain degree of faith or confidence or willing to try ethics at an ascendant level is necessary. So when we see what we're going to see in just a couple of verses, what those kinds of ethics are, what he's saying is at first you take them on faith and you try them, you see if they work. If they do work, you keep trying. As soon as they don't work, you investigate. But he does say wisdom is the chief. In other words, faith alone doesn't get you anywhere other than sort of preliminarily get you onto the playing field. Wisdom is what's chief in terms of the whole path, and wisdom analysis is what is going to be critical in terms of developing transcendence. One who does not neglect the practices through desire, hatred, fear, or bewilderment is known as one of faith, a superior vessel for ascendance. So one who does not neglect the practices through desire, hatred, fear, or bewilderment, those are the four things that would cause one to not want to try the kinds of ethics we're going to be discussing in a minute, and is therefore a superior vessel for trying on ascendance. Having analyzed well, so here's analysis, all the deeds of body, speech, and mind, those who realize what benefits self and others and always perform these are wise. So that's wisdom. Okay, so here are some examples. Some of you may well know this list, this famous list of the 10 non-virtues. This is one of the textual sources that comes from. Not killing, not stealing, forsaking the mates of others. Later that becomes rephrased as sexual misconduct of any sort. So not killing, not stealing, which is actually defined as not taking what is not given. So it's not just stealing, actually walking into somebody's room and stealing their stuff. It's also walking out of a restaurant without paying, or whatever, sort of indirectly taking something that wasn't explicitly given to you. That's how they define that. So not killing, not stealing, forsaking the mates of others, or sexual misconduct, those are the three of body. Four of speech are refraining completely from false speech, that's lying. Divisive speech, harsh speech, and senseless speech, the four of speech. And then thoroughly forsaking three mental things, covetousness, harmful intent, or malice, and then usually it's translated as false views. And here he specifically says the views of nihilists. These are the 10 gleaming paths of action, so not doing those 10 things are the gleaming paths of action. Their opposites, meaning doing those 10 things, are the dark path. And then he adds a few more. Not drinking intoxicants, a good livelihood, not harming, respectful giving, honoring the honorable, and love. Practice, in brief, is that. So notice meditation wasn't on that list. So practice, in brief, from Nagarjuna's point of view, is the well-known list of not doing the 10 non-virtues and doing the 10 virtues. That's secular ethics from a Buddhist point of view. Not doing those 10 and doing the 10 opposites is what it is to be an ethical person. Why would you want to do that? From a Buddhist point of view, those things either cause suffering or cause happiness just even here and now socially and psychologically. So that's the sort of secular side. And of course, in the long term, the idea is that you're actually developing yourself, you're evolving as a sentient being. And if you're doing any of these 10 negative things for whatever reason, it's creating the seeds for further delusion and further suffering, actually. So that doing those 10 things actually make you suffer. Not doing those 10 make you not suffer in the long term. Not necessarily moment by moment, but in the big picture. So skipping to verses 20 to 24 then. So desire, hatred, ignorance, and the actions they generate are non-virtues. Non-desire, non-hatred, non-ignorance are the actions they generate, are virtues. So here he's tying the virtues that we just discussed back to the three kleshas, or the three addictions, which you see in the center of the wheel of life in the Buddhist iconography. So these are really the root of all suffering from a Buddhist point of view. Desire, or attachment, or grasping, or lust, On the one side, there's sort of this gesture, and then there's this gesture, which is hatred or anger. But both of those are actually rooted in what he's translating here as ignorance. And the word marikpa in Tibetan, or avidya, it means more than ignorance. Ignorance usually just connotes not knowing something. Here it really means misknowing something. So misknowledge really is the root of the other two. So these are the three addictions or afflictions, they're sometimes called, or the three poisons, that cause all non-virtue and cause all suffering. So notice that the very, very root of all of that is misknowledge. And as you probably, many of you probably know, that's considered, from the Buddhist analysis point of view, that's the real root of the problem. You can boil it down to one thing, misknowledge. Misknowledge, and what does that mean? It means with respect to the nature of how things are. We think, and how do we think things are? We tend to think that we are separate entities. We are separate, we exist. I have a self, separate from yourself. Tables and chairs and birds and trees exist as concrete things. They're not interdependent upon me. They exist independently of me, just like you exist independently of me. And so if we're getting along, that's great. But as soon as there's a shortage of resources or some perception that my happiness needs this, then I might try to take this from you. But the very perception that I am separate from you, that things have their own categorical sort of separateness, that perception is considered, from the Buddhist point of view, we also think we know that. We don't just perceive it, we conceive it. And that is considered the fundamental misconception and misperception that generates all suffering. It immediately generates desire and hatred. You could see how that's the case. And the theory here that's being suggested is that all suffering actually comes from that. And that maybe makes sense if we could be convinced, in fact, that it's true that we're not, that separate selves don't exist. It does sort of make sense to us that if we're setting up a whole way of life based on a misconception or a misidea, that we're probably going to fail, right? If you have a misconception of the way things are, if you think the earth is flat and you set out, you won't set out on your ship because you think you're going to fall off the edge of the earth or whatever, you start making calculations and decisions based on a faulty model of reality, you're going to fail and you're going to suffer. If you act in life based on a validated model of reality, you're going to be successful and be happy more often than not. So the fundamental Buddhist psychophysical analysis of reality is that the main mistake everyone makes is thinking things exist separately and independently and intrinsically, whereas in fact they don't. Insofar as, it's not to say things don't exist, but insofar as things exist, they exist interdependently, like two sides of one coin, which you can have a heads and the tails side of a coin, you can flip the coin, make a decision based on that. We can all agree that it's tails, not heads, so there's right and wrong. But the heads and the tails side of the coin, although they seem to be independent things, aren't independent. You can't destroy one side of the coin without simultaneously destroying the other side of the coin. And you and me, you and I are similar in that sense. In other words, the very notion of a self is actually very much interdependently interlinked with everyone else. You can't separate it out. We saw how that sort of played out visually and effectively when we heard Thurman read the Avatamsaka Sutra. On this more analytical side, these are precisely the kinds of arguments the Nagarjuna spends a great amount of time arguing in this book and in the Fundamental Wisdom book that I pointed out earlier. If you're interested in studying this kind of philosophy, there's a lot to study. I'm not expecting to convince anybody of these arguments tonight. They can take months and years. But it's quite a detailed, systematic approach to really deconstructing the notion of, or even the coherency of, independent intrinsic entities, whether you're talking tables and chairs or the self. So that's what this is all coming down to, that all of those virtues, non-virtues we read a minute ago, are really rooted in desire, hatred, and ultimately misknowledge. From non-virtues come all sufferings, as I was saying, and likewise all bad transmigrations, bad rebirths, and from virtues all happy transmigrations or rebirths and pleasures of all lives. So within this worldview, again, some of you will be open to this and some may not, but within this worldview there is the notion that sentience or consciousness doesn't end at death. In fact, it didn't even start at birth. And so we have this idea of rebirth, of an infinite number of succession of lifetimes. And that is argued, again, not as an article of faith, but it's actually argued in the context, interestingly, of breaking down, does it even make sense to say that you are the same person you were when you walked in the room? There's a continuity there, like there could be a continuity with a candle flame and so forth, but when you really analyze it, what these texts try to do, when they really analyze it, to show that the notion of a continuous self itself as a fiction. And counterintuitively, actually, what that does, breaking down the notion of there being continuous self in this lifetime, actually ends up arguing in favor of the fact of a continuity, not a self, but a continuity existing sort of over infinite time. Again, I don't expect that to be immediately convincing, but this is kind of where they start to take the argument. So there is this notion of, anyway, that there is that it can be argued, it's not an article of faith, that what you are is a continuously evolving, what each of us is a continuously evolving sentient being. And by continuously evolving, that means every second. And so every action one does with body, speech, or mind contributes to that evolution, either in a negative way or a positive way. Insofar as one is practicing ethics on this ascendance level, the more of the virtuous kinds of ethics you practice, you're practicing a kind of ethics that's sort of in tune with the fact of interdependence, and you sow the seeds for greater happiness, basically. And you do the opposite, and you sow the seeds for greater suffering over time. And at the point when you do die, that's a major rupture. There is a major shift. There can be a major shift in body type. And if one's not fortunate enough to be born again as a human, born as an animal or in a hell realm or some other temporary realm, it's much more difficult to progress. But those realms are actually considered kind of like nightmare. There's a verse in Shantideva where it's asked, you know, where are the hell realm? Where are they? Are they underneath the earth? And where are they? And who made them? And he makes it very clear they're not anywhere. They're actually mental creations. So it is like a nightmare. Very much like in my favorite line in Harry Potter, where, do you remember that in the seventh book or the seventh movie where Harry Potter has died and he's in this weird limbo zone and Dumbledore's there and he's having this whole conversation with Dumbledore in a sort of a white room in the movie. And Dumbledore died, of course, a long time ago, but suddenly he's having this conversation with the wizard Dumbledore, his mentor. And somewhere in the conversation, he's like, well, wait a minute, sir, I'm talking with you and you died and maybe I die. Where is this? Where are we? What's going on here? Is this real or is this all in my head? And some of you may know Dumbledore's answer is, he says, well, my dear boy, of course this is all in your head, but why should that make it any less real? You know, a very Buddhist sort of response that he makes there. The notion that everything is essentially a mental creation, you could say. It's a dreamlike. They use that term, dreamlike or illusory-like. So the hell realms and the god realms, these are all illusory-like, but they're no less or more illusory-like than even right here, right now. So just when you go to bed tonight and you have a dream, we sort of know there's something unreal about that. In a similar way, maybe at a different level, but in a similar way, this is equally unreal. This is all dreamlike. But within this dreamlike reality, there are cause and effects that occur, and happiness and suffering occurs on the basis of those causes and effects. So this is ethics, this is being argued all on the level of not getting into transcendence or Buddhahood or anything like that. What we'll see then, of course, is that the notion of Buddhahood is not meaning being super, super virtuous, being good enough that you get to some sort of a heaven state that's sort of a pure land, as if that's some sort of final highest point within samsara. It's actually breaking through the illusion of this whole thing and being free of it in a way where one is actually free to interact with it. It's kind of like it's like a lucid dream, if you've ever had that or if you're aware of what that means, where you're in a dream and then you wake up within the dream and you recognize that you're dreaming, but you don't then physically wake up, so you stay within the dream. So you're still within the illusory reality of your dream, but you're awake. You're aware of the fact that you're in a dream. Transcendence or Buddhahood is something more like that, more than a super blissful state within samsara. So being born in a god realm, from a Buddhist point of view, A, it's a possibility, B, it's just an illusion like this, and C, it's not a goal. It's actually considered a hindrance, it's a problem. You don't want to be born in the god realm because it's too comfy. You become too complacent. So, and it's temporary anyway. Okay, so on the transcendence level then, 25 to 33, I've talked briefly about transcendence, about emptiness, about the notion that we don't have a self, at least we don't have the kind of self we think we have. And he's very cautious in many verses throughout this book to make it clear he's not saying nothing exists, he's not being a nihilist. But he is saying that the kind of self that we think we have is an illusion, and that specific kind of independent or intrinsically existing self doesn't exist. It couldn't exist. It's incoherent. So that teaching of selflessness or emptiness is what he's going to discuss now briefly in the section I'm calling Transcendence. And I'll read a few of those verses, 25 to 33. The doctrine of of transcendence are said by the conquerors, as the Buddhas, to be deep, subtle, and frightening to the childish who are not learned. Quote, I am not, I will not be, I have not, I will not have, close quote. That kind of statement frightens all the childish, but it extinguishes fear in the wise. By him who speaks only to help beings, it was said that all beings have arisen from the conception of I, that's the I habit, and are enveloped with the conception of mine, that's the mine habit. So, let's see, I'll read a little bit more. The I exists, the mind exists, in quotes, these are wrong as ultimates. Ultimately, that's not possible. Although conventionally, relativistically, that is you are you and I am I. Side of coin A and B, or heads and tails, those things exist. But ultimately, they don't exist as independent things. For the two, I and mine, are not established by a thorough consciousness of reality just as it is. That is, if you analyze carefully. The mental and physical aggregates, that's sort of body and mind, arise from the conception of I, which is false in fact. How could what is grown from a false seed be true? This is an unusual ramification of this theory, and that's this notion that the actual entire body-mind complex that we think we have, that we then identify with, is actually a construction of this confused misperception or misconception. So even body and mind, it's easier to say, perhaps, to say that the notion of self comes from this misconception. And we know this, one way to think about this, we know this certainly, if any of you have children or somebody that you have a great real bond with, real love for, you know that your sense of self can extend to that other person and include that other person to where if that other person is in any way harmed, you feel personally harmed, even to the point where you'd actually rather have that harm come to you instead of that other person. Could be a child, a mother, somebody else. And likewise with enemies. So the sense of self can either expand and include others or contract and include fewer, depending on your feeling of relationship to that other person. So it is somewhat arbitrary where does our sense of self end? Does it end with the skin, or does it include something beyond the skin? So anyway, here the suggestion is that the false sense of I actually produces, even genetically over multiple lifetimes, produces the actual body. It's like, again, like in a dreamlike or holographic kind of way. Having seen thus the aggregates, the body and mind, as untrue in this way, the conception of I is abandoned. The conception of I is abandoned. And due to abandoning the conception of I, the aggregates also arise no more. And here he means the conception as intrinsically real, not as relatively real, because that's never a problem. Just as it's said that an image of one's face is seen depending on a mirror, but does not really exist as a fact in the mirror, so the conception of I exists dependent on the aggregates. But like the image of one's face, the I does not really exist. Just as without depending on a mirror, the image of one's face is not seen, so too the conception of I does not exist without depending on the aggregates. And to bring in another example that he uses later on, he talks about a whirling firebrand. He gives a number of examples here. Let me see if the... I'll bring it in now because it's appropriate. Somewhere later on in the text, he brings in the example of a mirage. And he points out that when you see a mirage in the distance and you're in the desert and you think it's when you desperately need water and you see what looks like a lake, it's a mirage of water, it's heat wave, and you run over to it, and then you discover that it was a mirage, right? There wasn't water there. Number one, that's bad news. You needed that water. But number two, it's funny the way he puts it in here. He says, if you run over there and now you discover it was a mirage, to say that the water was destroyed, the way he puts it in the text later on, it would be stupid. He says only a stupid person would say the water was destroyed. Right? If you think about it, it's not that there was water there, which now that you get there, the water got destroyed. What's the case is when you get there, you realize, oh, there wasn't water there to begin with, right? And this is an analogy for the self. There's a perception that the self exists, which is really like a mirage. And when you see through that mirage and you recognize that the self doesn't exist in that way, it should not be the emotional and intellectual both response to that, seeing through the illusion of self, should not be, oh my God, myself was just destroyed. Nothing got destroyed in that. What happened was you saw that it was a mirage. So he uses that as an example later on. Again, to talk about how emptiness or selflessness is not nihilistic. It doesn't destroy things. It actually reveals the way things are. Like a reflection in a mirror or like a mirage. So yeah, so in these other verses coming up, I won't read through these now because I'm going to run out of time if I do. But a lot of these verses talk about what it means to be liberated, to understand that, why that entails liberation. And then these non-dual ones I've flagged as non-dual. Well, I'm going to read a couple of those because they're important. If nirvana, let me see, start on 46 maybe. If nirvana is not a non-thing, just how could it have thingness? The extinction of the misconception of things and non-things is called nirvana. In brief, the view of nihilism is that effects of actions do not exist. Without merit and leading to a bad, without that view, nihilism, being without merit and leading to a bad state, it's regarded as a wrong view. So, I'm not sure if that made sense, especially since you're not looking at the words on the page, but nirvana is not a non-thing, the first line I read. So nirvana, or extinction, is sometimes translated as extinction. Again, it's not some state of nothingness or state of where things are like a blown out candle. It's not a non-thing. It is the, and if it's not a non-thing, then how could it have thingness? It is precisely the seeing through of both. He's going to go on later on, I think, in this passage. It's a common thread that comes up throughout this text and throughout all these Madhyamaka texts, that the very notion of existence and non-existence themselves are binaries that mutually depend on each other. So it may, and the example he gives in here and elsewhere is long and short. And again, I don't know if I'll find the verse tonight, but long and short don't make sense without relationship to each other. Longness doesn't exist in a vacuum, right? They're mutually dependent terms. And the very teaching or doctrine, the Buddhist doctrine of interdependence or interdependent origination, right, pratita samutpada, it means very related things but in different contexts. One context in which that's explained is precisely linguistic, that long and short only exist in relation to each other. It doesn't make sense to talk about long without short, hot without cold, up without down, right? And like, so to think that longness could somehow exist metaphysically somehow kind of makes no sense. And interestingly, then that same analysis is applied to something that seems like a much more meta-level category of existence and non-existence. And so as the analysis goes, even existence and non-existence are mutually interdependent. If you show that the notion of existence, a particular kind of existence, let's say intrinsic existence, is incoherent, then that doesn't mean, aha, now you've proved non-existence. Just like if I show you that this isn't long, then I don't automatically prove that longness somehow doesn't exist. I guess it's short. It depends on who's doing the measuring and compared to what. So existence and non-existence likewise are mutually interdependent terms. They make sense insofar as you're referring to something where that's conventional or contextual. Okay, so the notion that nirvana is precisely the state of nirvana, or the view or the perception of nirvana is precisely that perception which transcends the idea that existence and non-existence really exist as things in themselves. Whether that label existence and non-existence then is applied to a table or a chair or to myself or to you or to anything else. Okay, so, yeah, and that's verse 73 then says, as I say there, nirvana does not mean the world disappearing because of that very reason. So in verse 73 he says, hence, in fact, there is no disappearance of the world through nirvana. Asked whether the world has an end, the conqueror remains silent. Because you can't answer that based on the terms that the person's asking the question, sort of a dualistic thinking. Does it exist or doesn't exist? The way he's talking here, it's like, it's neither nor. Does longness exist or not? It's like asking that. Well, you can't say it does or doesn't exist. You can say long as an adjective that, relatively speaking, is contrasted with short, and the notion of relative measurement exists as a conventional thing we agree on, but it doesn't sort of exist as an ontological category all by itself. Okay, so maybe in the question and answer period, if you want, we can get into this more. What might this mean to talk about the very notion of existence and non-existence being in a similar category? Because at first, it probably, if you haven't studied this type of material before, it does come across very counterintuitively. It should, because we have a, according to this analysis, we have a very, very deeply rooted habit pattern of precisely the opposite. The things do, I exist. Certainly, if nothing else, I know I exist. That I'm sure of. And I think you probably feel the same about yourself, and I don't know. And I'm pretty sure that, you know, certain things, my body exists, and my world exists, and my car exists. And you know, we start extending, and we start to think these things really exist in a very certain way, and we have a strong attachment to them. So the very notion, this is a very strongly rooted habit, is not just an intellectual habit, it's not just a philosophically learned habit, it's an instinctual habit. It's something that we have at birth, even. From the Buddhist point of view, that they say that. They say it actually comes with at birth, but not because it's part of human nature, not because it's something you can't potentially get rid of. It comes from birth because, precisely, it's that very I habit pattern, that reificatory habit pattern of thought. It's that precise pattern of reifying things that actually causes a continuity to occur in a samsaric realm in the first place. It's what causes us to create this illusionary dreamlike body that we now have. So it is counterintuitive. It should be counterintuitive just because both intellectually it's a little bit difficult to grasp at first, and then instinctually we feel this is not right. The whole point of the Madhyamaka philosophical program, the central way philosophical program, is precisely to engage in a series of philosophical analyses that are designed to show, rather than directly attacking the view of self or the view of existence, they actually go at it in a very Socratic way and say, well, okay, if self things seem to exist, tables and chairs and trees seem to exist as independent things. So if that's the case, what would that entail? What would it mean for the self to exist? And the Madhyamaka philosopher Nagarjuna starts asking questions and starts showing various inconsistencies arrive when you start drawing out the ramifications of what would it mean, like the two sides of the coin thing. What would it mean to say the A side or the head side of the coin exists independently of the other side? When you start thinking that through, you start running into some logical conundrums, right? And the point of doing this kind of exercise is to undermine intellectually at first what we thought made coherent sense. At some point, a sort of a cognitive dissonance arises in the philosopher doing this, where they begin to think, oh my gosh, my whole world's actually falling apart. I'm actually going to lose myself. That's why he had that verse earlier where he said, you know, actually, you're not losing anything. You're seeing through it. But that level of crisis actually needs to occur at an intellectual level first. So it needs to be logically, philosophically shown first that the notion of independent existence is incoherent, actually. And if and only if you've seen it to be incoherent sort of intellectually, then you can start to figure out ways to then have that realization start to undermine the instinctual habit pattern, which is much more difficult to uproot. But that's precisely where various meditative practices come in, is to start to bring your cognitive awareness to bear on your sort of precognitive sense of how things are. Okay, so anyway, so nirvana does not mean the world disappears, because that would mean samsara exists, or so I thought it did, and nirvana means samsara doesn't exist. So now I'm in a state of nothingness. And the whole point, in fact, a very big chapter in the other book by Nagarjuna, a very big point in the 24th chapter, a very famous chapter, is where he talks about the non-duality of samsara and nirvana. Just like the two sides of one coin, exactly. Samsara and nirvana are necessary sort of reflections of each other. You don't have nirvana without samsara and vice versa. Nirvana is the absence of, or the seeing through of, samsara. Also, you don't have emptiness in a vacuum. Emptiness doesn't exist as sort of a metaphysical something in Buddhist thought, even though it has the abstract suffix ness, N-E-S-S, right? Emptiness means precisely the lack of intrinsic reality in anything you want to point to. So it's a negative thing. It's not something that exists. So I'm going to go more quickly now and read a few less verses. It's about 8 o'clock and we go till 9 o'clock, right? So if I stop in half an hour, we'll have some time for some conversation. So the chapter 2 of the 5 chapters then, Nagarjuna discusses what Hopkins translates as the interwoven is the name of the chapter. And as we see, it's the interwoven causes and effects of ascendance and transcendence. So the ways in which those are interrelated. So some verses on transcendence and some verses on ascendence. I think I'm going to jump forward to verse 124 and 5. Skip that first section, just in the interest of time, where he says, if this doctrine, that's the doctrine of emptiness that we've been talking about, he's going back and forth, right, from the sort of the relative ascendance ethics level to this more transcendent thing we've been discussing recently. If this doctrine of emptiness or selflessness is not understood thoroughly, the conception of an I will prevail, will continue. And hence will come virtuous and non-virtuous actions, which will then give rise to good and bad rebirths. So the thing will continue until you've thoroughly seen it. Therefore, as long as the doctrine removing the conception of I is not known thoroughly, until you've had thorough, complete, clear insight into emptiness or selflessness, until that time at least, take heed of the practices of giving, ethics, and patience. And earlier we skipped a verse where he basically says, ascendance can be reduced to those three, giving, ethics, and patience. Giving, ethics, and patience. And those are, many of you will recognize within Mahayana, broader Mahayana ethics. There's some verses coming up that will discuss this. There are the 6 paramitas, or the 6 transcendences, they can be called, or the 6 perfections. And you may have heard of these as being the perfection or the transcendence of generosity, ethics, patience, or sometimes translated tolerance, energy, meditation, and wisdom. Right, those are the 6 things that any bodhisattva practices. Mahayana Buddhism 101, that's what you do. You do those 6 things. In this book, interestingly, from 2,000 years ago, those 6 are already clearly present as a set of 6, but he frequently adds a 7th thing, I'm not sure why, of compassion. So he says the 6 paramitas and compassion. For that matter, if you want to start broadening the list, you can talk about, they sometimes talk about the 10 paramitas. But the 6 is a common list. The 6 paramitas, here he says, usually, and compassion. You could also say, and bodhicitta. You had the talk last night by the Lama on bodhicitta, or the spirit of awakening. Another way to distill Mahayana ethics is really just in the bodhicitta. And I don't know if he talked about it, because I wasn't able to see the talk, but sometimes they talk about bodhicitta, or the spirit of awakening, having 2 types, a relative and ultimate bodhicitta. Relative bodhicitta is precisely the altruistic spirit of wanting to awaken to become a Buddha for the sake of other beings. So it's basically compassion on steroids, or compassion infused with wisdom, with the goal of becoming a Buddha. That's relative bodhicitta, and then what's called ultimate bodhicitta is precisely the wisdom or insight into emptiness or selflessness. So once again, you could sort of say all of Mahayana Buddhism boils down into bodhicitta, which has 2 types, relative and ultimate. That's compassion and wisdom again. So there's different ways in which these things kind of overlap and can be fit into each other. So here he's saying of the 6 paramitas, the first 3 in particular, and they're oftentimes split this way, the first 3 are giving, ethics, and patience. Those are the things a person should focus on. So those are ascendant level ethics, right? Ethics here being defined as the 10 non-virtues we discussed, of not harming and trying to help. So practicing generosity, practicing ethics the way we discuss, and practicing patience or tolerance. Those first 3 paramitas in particular should be the focus of somebody until they've actually seen emptiness completely. It's not that once you've seen emptiness or selflessness completely that you then abandon those. And again, that's a major theme of what Kyon argues in his book, because there have been some Western scholars and occasionally some Buddhists who get confused about that and think once you've gotten wisdom, ethics and all these other things go out the window, you don't need those anymore, you can do crazy wisdom and do whatever you want. That's definitely not the case. But what is the case is that those no longer become a focus, in a sense, because they become automatic. Once you've thoroughly seen emptiness, what that means is you've thoroughly seen the interdependence. Because remember, emptiness doesn't just mean nothingness, Emptiness specifically means it's a synonym for interdependence. There's a famous verse by Nagarjuna in another book where he says three terms are synonymous. Shunyata, that's emptiness. Pratityutsamutpada, that's interdependence or interdependent origination. And the middle way. Those are synonyms, he says, eka artha, they're synonyms. So emptiness means interdependence. It means you and I are thoroughly, there's no aspect of you, of your entire body, mind, your history, your psychology, your philosophy, your social embeddedness, that is, there's no part of that that is not intimately interrelated with mine. You and I are thoroughly interrelated. Now, if you see that, if you see emptiness, in other words, that way, if you see interdependence that way, you're essentially going to automatically act generously, but it won't feel like generosity. The example they give is if your hand's in the fire, you just take it out. And you don't say, that was so generous of me. I saved my own hand. You know, it's not a generous act to take your hand out of a burning fire. Nor is it a generous act for one hand to pick up a pair of tweezers and pull a thorn out of your other hand, right? So likewise, generosity is sort of this automatic reflex. When you've thoroughly seen it, it no longer becomes a focus. Generosity is automatic. Ethics, that's not harming, is automatic. And patience or tolerance is likewise becomes automatic. So that's what's being said here, is until that time, until such time as ascendance, and particularly wisdom, until such time as the transcendent side of this program is thoroughly developed, the ascendant side needs to be focused on. But again, once the transcendent side has begun to be fully experienced, that doesn't mean the ascendant side goes away. It just means it's no longer the focus. It becomes more automatic. It's not your sort of primary training. I love this. I won't read it, but later on he talks about giving general kingly advice, and then he's talking to a king. And it's funny, at one point he starts saying, look, king, the kind of advice I want to give you, sometimes the best advice, the most useful advice, isn't always the most pleasant to hear. And I'm now going to give you some advice. You know, please don't throw me in prison, but I'm going to tell you, Mr. King here, some things you may not want to hear. And he starts talking to him about, you know, detachment and giving up his harem and giving up wine and liquor and all the kinds of things and hunting and being a vegetarian. But he obviously has a good audience here with this king. This king seemed to respect what he was saying. But he talks several times about, just like if you have a disease, he uses the example, you're diagnosed with a bad disease and a doctor you trust gives you a medicine that's really, really tastes terrible and may even have really terrible side effects. You're going to take it anyway, even though it's going to cause some minor temporary suffering, because you know the long-term benefit. So likewise, some of these practices that I'm now going to suggest, you may not like them, but they're for your own good, type of thing. So on the transcendent level, in verses 174 and 5, this is one of the few times in this text where he talks about bodhicitta specifically. Other texts, he talks about it all over the place. That particular term comes up in those verses where he says bodhicitta, compassion, and wisdom are the roots of Buddhahood, as we mentioned a minute ago. And the form and truth bodies of the Buddha actually derive directly from merit and wisdom. And he has a number of nice verses about don't be discouraged, I would have read, only because I find a lot of people studying this kind of material, those who particularly try practicing it for a number of years, do end up at some point becoming very, very discouraged. And there's some very nice verses, both in Shantideva as well as in Nagarjuna, that really talk to sort of what happens to somebody at the intermediate level who's been doing this for a few years, and you hit a point where you become very disheartened or discouraged. Precisely, at first it's fun and it's easy and you feel all holy and spiritual and great, but at some point, when you realize how intractable the ego is and how much it just doesn't want to give up and how embedded your own kleshas are, your addictions are, at some point it's quite common to feel depressed, discouraged. I mean, the list of bad feelings goes on and on. And there's some really, really helpful verses both in this text as well as Shantideva's where he talks about why you shouldn't let that happen. And interestingly, one of the arguments why you shouldn't let that happen, if I jump forward to where that is, I'm not sure if I can find it quickly. Yeah. Check this out. In chapter 5, he actually talks about you should relinquish. I'm going to read it because I'm on that topic. Chapter 5, verse 407. He's talking about multiple types of pride, seven types of pride in particular. And what I want to call your attention to on verse 407, this is interesting. He says, one type of pride is fancying that one is lower than the lowly. or equal to the equal or greater than or equal to the lowly. This is called the pride of selfhood. Now, that's counterintuitive because we all usually think of pride. The word is mana or nagyal in Tibetan or mana in Sanskrit. We usually think of pride as just only being inflated. I'm bigger, I'm better than you. But within Buddhist psychological discourse, that's one kind of pride for sure. But interestingly, there's another kind of pride which is exactly the opposite of, I'm so lousy and I'm such a schmuck and I'm useless and I'm no good. And that's actually considered a type of pride. And it's actually considered a huge hindrance to spiritual progress. Why? Precisely because what you're doing is you're overinflating your own ability, you're over deflating your own ability. I'm just so useless and hopeless, I'm no good. And what that's doing is then giving you an excuse. I guess I might as well have another drink, because I can't beat this addiction anyways. So it's considered a form of pride that's actually considered just as bad as the other form. And in the other verse, which is 4:12, he says, deriding oneself, thinking, quote, I'm useless, is called the pride of inferiority. And then such is a brief description of the seven prides. And those of you who may have studied tantric theory and practice will know, but I'll mention briefly. It's interesting in tantric theory, where you're taking on a form of practice where you're visualizing yourself as a Buddha. You're sort of using visualization to visualize that this is already a mandala, things are already a Buddha field, I'm already a Buddha, while on some level acknowledging you're not, also acknowledging that in a way you're not. You know, you can kind of dream, you can sort of, there's a continuity between the potential of yourself being a future Buddha and who you are now. There's at least a continuity there. And so you're sort of playing a game with time and you're putting yourself in the future Buddhahood state and imagining that you're already there in visualization. And you're also imagining everybody else is already there, not just you. So everything's already that way. Again, the Avatamsaka Sutra that Professor Thurman read the other night sort of started to invoke that in an exoteric way. In esoteric tantric practice, you're doing that in a way where you're visualizing this externally, but you're also doing it on various internal yogas that are sort of bringing that out and so forth. It becomes a very, very powerful practice. It's called deity yoga or Buddha yoga, a powerful psychological practice. And interestingly, because you are imagining that you're already in this perfect state, the primary downfall or sin, in quotes, in the tantric vehicle is precisely called the pride of ordinariness. Because you're imagining that you're extraordinary. You're not imagining that you're ultimate, that you intrinsically exist, or this is your real nature. Again, this is something people get confused a lot about. My real nature is I'm a Buddha, and my fake nature was I'm a samsaric being. No, they're both equally relatively true or possible. They're both equally ultimately empty. But there is a difference in that the ordinary samsaric limited suffering being that I am now, that's pretty ordinary. And the free, blissful, interconnected being that's a Buddha, that's pretty extraordinary. So that's the terminology they use. They call it extraordinary and ordinary. You become extraordinary when doing this practice. So in tantric practice, the number one, and I'll, in the four-part course I'm going to give on ethics, we'll end on that. We'll talk about tantric ethics at the end, and we'll expand upon that further. But just in brief, it's interesting. In tantric practice, the pride of ordinariness is the number one sin or downfall or thing you're trying to avoid. But here, even on an exoteric level, Nagarjuna is saying one of the seven types of pride is the pride of inferiority or the pride of being so low and humble. So I just wanted to jump forward to that. There are a lot of verses in here. I'm just going to read a couple examples. Maybe where he's giving advice to the king on a social political level. Interestingly, there's quite a, in fact, more than half this text, he's talking on that level. So he's saying, you, Mr. King, as a ruler, you should do things to benefit, because you're in a position of power, you should do things to benefit your populace that will help them develop these things. First of all, why not? I mean, why not be generous if you're going to aspire to be a bodhisattva? You're bothering to listen to me. I'm going to tell you, be a bodhisattva, be generous. And be generous how? What does that look like? Well, he spells it out. And there's an article I will flip to here real quickly that you can look up, written by Thurman, called Guidelines for Buddhist Social Activism Based on Nagarjuna's Jewel Garland of Royal Councils. And you can see the source there, the Eastern Buddhist 16, number 1, spring 1983. What Thurman does in this is he extracts out of here all those verses that are specifically talking to the king about basically social service programs. Here are, and extracts out of that a whole social political theory, a Buddhist 2,000-year-old social political theory. And as he, I think, rightly unpacks it, this is a social political theory that would be appropriate not only to a monarchy, but to a democracy or whatever political system is in place at the time. So he then tries to spell out, pull out of this a whole social political theory applicable to today. As some of you may know, he does that even further. This was back in 1983. In a subsequent book, he writes an entire book. Thurman writes an entire book called Inner Revolution, Life, Liberty, and the Pursuit of True Happiness. And that entire book is a book of trying to, drawing on this and other sources, to develop a social political theory, a Buddhist social political theory. But if you want to look that up, you can read even more about that. But I'm just going to read a few verses to give you a flavor of what he suggests. 231. Let's go to 231. And then we'll stop for questions and discussion. I think we're almost there. You should respectfully and extensively construct, now this is the Buddhist part, this is the religious part, construct images of Buddha, monuments, and temples, and provide residences, abundant riches, and so forth. And it's important, too, and when we do the Nalanda talk, we'll explain more about this, what it means to be a Buddhist, and why would you do Buddhist images. Again, that's misunderstood, sometimes even by Buddhists. The idea of having a Buddha statue or Buddha painting, it's not that those are idols or objects that themselves are supposed to be worshipped. They are clearly visual examples of the kinds of things we've been talking about. There's this notion that actually your body becomes, when you practice giving and patience and ethics and meditation and so forth, it actually gradually, evolutionarily transforms your body. In a way, your body actually becomes a reflection of those ethical qualities. And therefore, a one type of archetypal body that represents that is a Buddha's body. So in building a Buddha statue, the reason for doing that is precisely because it's a visual image that inspires others to develop those qualities, which in a Buddhist society, they know what those connections are. But anyway, he says, of course, that's not surprising. He tells the king you should build Buddhist statues and monuments and temples. But then he goes on, please construct from all precious substances, not only images of the Buddha, but you should sustain and well sustain with all endeavor the excellent doctrine and the communities of monasteries, decorate monuments with gold and jewels and friezes, revere the monuments, etc. Listen to the teachers. You should make donations of pages and books and the treatises that they give rise to, the shastras, along with the prerequisites, pens and ink. He has a whole long section here about actually building schools and giving, provide for the livelihood of teachers and give lands to them. He talks a lot about setting up schools and universities, which actually does go on and take place, again, as we'll see in the month when I'm talking about Nalanda, and we'll see exactly what those are. They're not just Buddhist establishments. They really are sort of ecumenical university settings that do end up being built. In order to alleviate, now, in addition to providing for teachers and building institutions, in order to alleviate the suffering of sentient beings, the old, the young, and the infirm, you should establish through the estate that you control doctors and barbers throughout your country. Please provide hostels, make them available. Provide hostels, parks, dikes, ponds, rest houses, water vessels, beds, food, hay, wood. Please establish rest houses in all towns, at temples and the cities, and provide water vessels on all the roadways and crossroads. Always care compassionately for the sick. He talks about setting up hospitals. This is one of my favorite verses then. Please have small containers in the shade filled with sesame, rice, grains, food, molasses, and suitable water. And then at the openings of anthills, please have trustworthy persons always put food, water, sugar, and piles of grain. He wants the king to take care of the ants in his kingdom. And there's another verse where he talks about taking care of animals in general. And in another, eliminate robbers and thieves in your own and others' countries, set prices fairly, and keep profits level. There's a whole economic thing in here where he talks about really, essentially, it's the Bernie Sanders platform. It's really the equal distribution of wealth. It's an analysis, and by the way, there's sutras from the Buddha, Pali sutras from 500 years before this, where the Buddha puts forth a really brilliant, really contemporary analysis of precisely what happens when economic disparity starts to get too out of balance, precisely how crime rises, and then punishment arises, and based on punishment, more people become more violent, and then militias grow. He has this whole sort of, based on an economical model, a whole social political analysis of how society gets out of whack, basically, and what you need to do to not let things get too out of balance economically. So here he's saying specifically, sort of based on things like in that sutra, he talks about keeping taxes under control. He talks about making sure that people don't hoard land too much, that there's enough to go around and so forth. There's a lot of economic advice given in here. If you provide facilities for those most deprived who lack the means to study the doctrine, then there's no greater gift than that. So he talks about giving people free education and so forth. There's a lot of social and political advice given in this particular chapter. And then later on, he gives another set of examples. See, what is that? This is nice here on page verse 328 about prison reform. That's an important section about the role of punishment. He talks a lot about how to really lessen crime and diminish crime as much as possible, but then given that there's still going to be people who, for whatever reason, do things, in another section he talks a lot about setting up a good government with ministers that you trust, but also spies who then spy on, or they're called spies in here, I'm not sure what the word is, but who actually go in and look sort of clandestinely at what are people actually doing, what they were instructed to do, basically like IRS agents or something. Agents who go out both within your administration, but then also in borderlands to just keep tabs on what's happening. So given that things are going to get violent at times, what do you do? And so in verses 328, since in this world nowadays most are prone to wreak havoc on each other, listen to how your governance and your practice should be. Let there always be around you many persons, old and experienced, of good lineage, knowing good policy, who shrink from ill deeds, are agreeable, and know what should be done. Even to those whom they have rightfully fined, bound, punished. So you have these people, essentially a police force, but who are compassionate and generous, but who are going to exercise some authority to keep things in check. So those people, even when those good people whom they have rightfully fined, bound, punished, and so forth, you, the king, being moistened with compassion, should always be caring towards these people who've been jailed or whatever. O king, through compassion, you should always generate just an attitude of altruism, even for all those embodied beings who have committed awful ill deeds. Especially generate compassion for those whose ill deeds are horrible, the murderers. Those of fallen nature are receptacles of compassion from those whose nature is magnanimous. Free the weaker prisoners after a day or 5 days. Do not think the others are not to be freed under any conditions. So no Guantanamos. For each one of whom you do not think to free, you will lose the layperson's vow. So if you think this person is a goner, I'm never going to free him from jail ever, and the guardian is saying, you've just lost your ethical vow, your vow of what we were talking about earlier. Due to having lost that vow, faults then will continuously be amassed. As long as prisoners are not freed, so far they have to be kept incarcerated for whatever reason, for however long, in that context they should be made comfortable with barbers, baths, food, drink, medicine, and clothing. Just as deficient children are punished out of a wish to make them competent, so punishment should be carried out with compassion, not through hatred or desire for wealth. So just like in the case with the children, the whole point of the incarceration is to really rehabilitate them. It's a rehabilitatory model, which, again, our contemporary prison systems are supposed to follow these kinds of guidelines, but do kind of anything but. Once you have analyzed and thoroughly recognized the angry murderers, so those who are really the bad ones in your prisons, you're going to look at them carefully. You're not just going to necessarily let them all out right off the bat. But if you really find somebody who's really kind of beyond rehabilitation, then, and this worked in ancient India, I don't know how it would work today, the result is, the suggestion is you have them banished without killing or tormenting them. No capital punishment, you banish them. Now again, that might have worked back then, and I've always wondered myself, how does that work exactly? If you banish a really bad guy, you could banish him to the jungle, but he's not going to necessarily just stay in the jungle. And then these days you could. You banish him to somebody else's country, not so good for the other country. So I'm not sure, but the point is here, you really want to think this through, and you don't just execute them. So there's a lot, and the advice goes on and on and on about prison reform, educational reform, Medicaid, welfare, et cetera, taxes. There's again, probably half of what's in here is about that. So what's interesting about that, I think, and then I'll sort of close up here. Probably what's interesting, if you've never studied this kind of material before, it's not necessarily that surprising. If probably the more years you may have studied Buddhism, the more this may surprise you, probably because in the West in particular, Dharma is not taught as being this. Dharma is taught as meditation, it's self-gratifying, it's my liberation, it's my breath, it's sort of almost a self-indulgent kind of practice. And the notion that you should be socially, politically engaged in any way is a whole other subject that we won't go into tonight, but there's been movements in recent decades of what's called socially engaged Buddhism, and it's created somewhat of a split within Western Dharma practitioners. There's those who say, how can you not be socially engaged? Come on, Buddhism calls for that. And in a way, they're right. They're actually drawing in this kind of material. But they might get pulled too far into that and lose the forest for the trees kind of thing. In other words, they lose the transcendent piece of it, and they get just into the confronting the enemy right now, whether it's Exxon or the terrorists or whomever. And it's all fine and good to confront problems in the world, but if you lose your practice of ethics and compassion and patience and so forth, then you're actually confronting of those problems won't be effective. So you kind of have to do both. But in the social engaged movements, some people lose that. And in the more meditation Dharma-centered movements, they're like, well, we don't need that external stuff. We're just going to meditate and become Buddhas. I'm going to meditate. I'm going to take prayer for all sentient beings. And then the first person who cuts me off in traffic, I'm going to be yelling at him and kicking it. Right? Me too. So a useful translation, actually, that Jeffrey Hopkins, among others, points out is that many Buddhist prayers and aspirations refer to all sentient beings. May I develop this or that for the sake of all sentient beings. And the term sarva, or tamche in Tibetan, it does mean all, but it doesn't just mean all as a collective noun, which is precisely where you get in trouble. It means each and every. And if you retranslate that and use it in your own aspirational thoughts or prayers or whatever, each and every, it changes the calculus quite significantly. I'm going to practice ethics today. You wake up in the morning. I'm going to try today to be a good person, be a little bit more wise, compassionate, patient, etc., with each and every individual I meet. That means the guy who cuts you off in traffic then, suddenly he's one of those each and every. So it kind of reframes it in a way. Anyway, I'm bringing this up just to say that the way in which Buddhism tends to be practiced in Dharma centers in the West tends to be more this sort of self-quieting, self-indulging, peaceful kind of practice, which tends to disengage from the rest of the world. I'm critical of that when I give talks at Dharma centers and definitely teaching classes at Columbia. I make it real clear that, as in this book, it's really throughout Buddhist countries and Buddhist texts and Buddhist history, it's not the case that the inner and the outer, the personal and the social, are divorced in this way. This is something we in the West have sort of done. Of course it happens historically at various places throughout Asia. People are people. But for the vast most part in Buddhist countries, it's very, very clear that the inner and the outer, the personal and the social, are completely interconnected. And so personal transformation goes hand in hand with social transformation and vice versa. So it shouldn't be surprising, actually, then, to see a book like this in which Nagarjuna, who's usually understood to be the great deconstructor of everything, and in some of his texts he does just do that, is also one of the greatest writers about reconstructing everything. Reconstructing everything as a Buddha field socially. So you get all this kind of advice. Here's how that looks on the ground if you're going to be a king. And you don't just have to be a king. He says, I'll just read this last verse and then we'll break for discussion. But as I mentioned at the outset, he says this isn't just for kings. Verse 498, so the second, third to last verse. These doctrines were not just taught only for monarchs, for kings like you, but were taught with a wish to help all other sentient beings as befits them. So this advice is really for anybody. Okay, so why don't we, there's many other verses I would have been delighted to discuss. You've seen some of the topics go by here on the six transcendences and so forth, but I'm sure I've covered way more than enough that we can have a good question and answer and dialogue at this point. And we have, good, just a little more than half an hour. So it's open to whatever you'd like to discuss. Yes?
All right, so two questions.
Hey, Matt?
Yeah.
Can you use
it? Oh, yeah.
Oh, the microphone, yes.
Okay, cool. All right, so two questions. First one is, if we're going to be going out and trying to be compassionate, be ethical with each and every person, how do we balance? I mean, I guess it would just come down to use your own judgment, but is there any thing written down about how to go about using your judgment?
How to balance?
Yeah, if you can only help so much or do so much for some people.
Right.
Or is it just the most good for the most people?
Right. Now, that's a very good question. And there are verses in both Shantideva's book and in this book. I can't find them right away, but they're in both books, where both authors, Shantideva and Nagarjuna, very explicitly talk about that. And they talk basically about it being a graded system. That based, you know, yes, there's the aspiration to be able to give away all your possessions and even give away your body, right? You get these kinds of things in Mahayana texts. But then they also make it, these authors make it very clear that if you're not able to do that with detachment and without anger and resentment and jealousy, in other words, let's say you give away a little bit more than you were comfortable, and now you're angry that you that person, you know, you didn't want to, but you did it because you thought you should. That actually is not beneficial. And so therefore, your intuition is right. That notion that you should be self-evaluative constantly and always evaluate what is sort of your range. And definitely push the whole point, of course, is to push yourself a little bit out of your comfort zone. If it's easy to give away a dollar, mm-hmm. and you just give away a dollar to two or three beggars, and that's no problem because your salary is such that that's no big deal, well, that's great. But have you really increased have you moved yourself in the direction of being able to give away everything without resentment or anger? And if you day to day you haven't moved in that direction, then you're just stagnating. You haven't moved in. That doesn't mean you're a bad person. It doesn't mean you're going to hell. It doesn't mean, what it means is, from Nagarjuna's point of view, you haven't moved the needle. You haven't evolved. The whole point is evolution, sort of in this ascendance way. And the idea is, the more you're ethically pushing yourself, it's literally like evolving, almost like in a Darwinian sense, that you're evolving as your psyche is evolving. You're evolving to a more open, wise, compassionate, ethical person. And that actually, if you do it, and you do it well, and you do it without, again, misconception and resentment, it actually makes you happier. You actually should feel the results of it, and you should be feeling more able to give more and be more patient, than maybe not the next time, like the next day, but in the long run. Another thing I'll just say quickly in response to that I found really helpful was when I heard the Dalai Lama say in a public talk about 20 years ago, maybe, he said that one thing he's noticed with Western practitioners in particular, it doesn't have to be Buddhist practitioners, it could just be Western people, you know, psychologists, it could be anybody, but with Westerners in particular, is that they're very short-sighted and they very want quick results, right? We know that. But with spiritual practice or psychological practice or whatever we want to call this, you really have to look over the long term to see what is the effect, and then to tweak it accordingly. And he specifically cited the time frame of 10 years. He said, so you practice, whether you're practicing this kind of thing as a Buddhist, or you're practicing this as a Christian, or you're practicing just as a secular person without a particular religious affiliation or goal, if you take on this kind of practice seriously, this kind of development, this kind of evolution seriously, then after 10, you should be on a day-to-day, you know, minute-to-minute, like evaluating and checking. But it's really at the 10-year mark that you look back and you ask yourself, okay, how much better am I in those various ways, according to those various criteria, according to my own criteria? And then you tweak accordingly and you go on to the next 10 years. I mean, in a way, that's mind-blowing probably to us to think of 10 years. I mean, I only have a few decades left, you know? But that's the point is that it is really the long-term game that we're looking at here. But the long-term game, the gradual, slow evolution, you look at it that way, but you also do it very, very incrementally, almost every single second as well. So there's the micro looking, you know, micro adjusting, but then just looking at the long term. And if you make mistakes, if you do end up, you know, blowing up at your husband or wife or kicking the dog or yelling at the guy in traffic, those are inevitable. Not that you give yourself license or an excuse to do that, but you, to some extent, you have compassion with yourself after the fact that you did do that. And so instead of sinking into despair and beating yourself up and taking on, like I read, the pride of lowliness or the pride of inferiority, you instead encourage yourself, you know, okay, I'm going to try again harder the next time. There's a Western Russian, I think, psychologist named Vygotsky who has a phrase he talks about that I like very much called the zone of proximal development. And that phrase applies very much to this. There's a zone of proximal development, proximal meaning nearby. So you're here in terms of your patience, let's say, level. You know, you blow up really easily if these things happen, but not so bad if those things happen. Overall, you consider yourself in this range. It's not too big of a stretch to say I could be that patient, but it's impossible for me to be this patient, at least now. So that's your zone of proximal development right there. That's what Vygotsky, the Western psychologist, says. And that's where you should be pushing. You should be pushing yourself into that zone. And once you're comfortably, once you've moved the needle to where that's your new set point, so to speak, then it becomes here. And you just keep doing that with all of these different types of things, all these different ethical principles and norms and goals. So that's a long answer.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm sure. Gonna forego my next question because I kind of want people to have time for theirs as well.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you for a lovely talk. I wanted to ask you, you spoke about conventional.
Speak up just a little.
You spoke about conventional and ultimate bodhicitta.
Yes.
Can you just say more about why ultimate bodhicitta is understood as the wisdom of emptiness?
Why ultimate bodhicitta is...
Is understood as the wisdom of emptiness?
Why it's understood as that? Well, bodhicitta, the term, of course, itself means... Bodhi means awakening. Right? The word Buddha means an awakened one. It's just a past passive participle. Bodhi means awakened. A bodhisattva is a sattva here doesn't just mean a being, it means a hero. So bodhisattva is a hero of awakening, or because it is a heroic journey. It's a heroic enterprise to try to wake up. It's not easy. So bodhisattva is a hero of awakening. A Buddha is somebody who has awoken. Bodhicitta, citta here doesn't just mean mind. It can be translated in some contexts. It can mean mind. But here, citta means something that's more active. It means something, that's why the translation spirit is nice. Like we have a team spirit in sports, that's the spirit. So the spirit of awakening, right? What is the spirit of awakening? On a relative level, it's aware, it's interconnected. It's the drive to want to wake up so that you can help other beings. It's actually, it helps to understand bodhicitta, relative bodhicitta, before I get to your question about ultimate bodhicitta. It helps to understand relative bodhicitta as being a logical, something that exists at the logical endpoint of a progression, going from love to compassion to great compassion, objectless compassion to bodhicitta. Love is a difficult thing to define, right? Many, many poets and writers have struggled with this, and college students, I think, struggle with what is love and what do you mean you love me? It's nice that the Buddhists have a very, very clean definition for love. Does anybody know the Buddhist definition of love? Yes, exactly. And that's a very clean definition, the wish that somebody else be happy. Notice that that definition just strips out of it all the kind of ego, what am I going to get from you? If that feeling, instead of thinking of it as an abstract idea, just imagine what you feel like when you feel with your son or your daughter or your dog or your cat or some best friend, when it's just a spontaneous feeling of You want them to be happy. And maybe something good happens to them and you feel joy, you feel sympathetic joy. You're like, yeah, that's great, they got what they wanted. That's love, okay? A step up from that is kind of a little bit more mature than that is compassion. And it's a logical extension of that, but it's considered a little bit more mature, a little bit more difficult to cultivate. And again, a difficult word to define, but the Buddhists have a clean, simple definition, which is the wish that somebody else not suffer. So the wish that somebody else be free of suffering. And sometimes that even extends to meaning to doing something, for you, maybe giving up something of yourself so that that being doesn't suffer. So if that's compassion, then at some point in wishing that someone else not suffer, we all know, have the experience of wishing that someone else not suffer but not having the means to do anything about it, or maybe not sufficient means to do enough about it. And that can trigger, or from the Buddhist point of view, that eventually can trigger, if it's understood, if the possibility of liberation and Buddhahood are not just seen as sort of religious beliefs or speculative ideas, but the possibility of evolving, even if that's considered a logical endpoint, Buddhahood, even if you're not a Buddhist and you think, well, I could at least evolve more in that direction, even if that's sort of an impossibility to get here, the more you start to think that's possible to go in that direction or maybe even to go all the way to there, the more it becomes clear that to be fully awake means to be fully aware of the intricacies of cause and effect and interdependence. It means actually, it's like Neo in the Matrix. It's actually seeing the complexities of all the interdependence of what's going on. And we know this just day to day. The more you know the complexities that led to a situation of a person who's suffering, the more you know their backstory, their history, their family history, their social history, et cetera, maybe the economic climate that's going on, the more you can assess really, the more details you know, the better you can address that suffering and maybe do something that's really going to be effective. It may not be immediately effective, it may not even be what the person thinks they need, but you can maybe feel that what you're going to do now is going to really help them in the long run. So there's this idea that the more you wake up, the more you're closer to Buddhahood, the more you see interdependence, the more effective you can be. So bodhicitta, relative bodhicitta then, in a Buddhist paradigm, it means the realization and the drive, wait a minute, I so much want to help other beings, I want to help each and every other being, and I want to help each and every other being in every way possible that I could possibly help them. And in order to do that, I have to be fully awake, ultimately. Doesn't mean I'm going to put everyone else on hold until I'm fully awake, but I'm now realize I need to become a Buddha. Why? Not just for my own benefit, in fact, not even primarily for my own benefit, really because I want to be maximally effective in helping others. And I realize that the way I can maximally help others is to become fully awake, to become a Buddha. That's relative bodhicitta. Ultimate bodhicitta, then, is the recognition or the perception of emptiness, and it's actually connected one step back with what's called great compassion. So we talked about compassion. Great compassion, or sometimes objectless compassion, is again, there's some verses about that in Nagarjuna. It's a common theme throughout all Mahayana texts. It's something that's initially somewhat strange and counterintuitive to us, objectless compassion. That's the compassion that has compassion for the other sentient being right in front of you. You have compassion for them while at the same time you don't see them as a separate sentient being. So it's objectless in the sense, like subject-object. There's not a subject-object split between us. So at first it seems strange because it seems like it would be devoid of emotion. That's the point. It's devoid of the kind of attachment that normally gets mixed in. To give you an anecdotal story, there was another experience with the Dalai Lama that was very moving. Some of you may have been there up at Menla when he was there a few years ago, talking to a group of nurses. And these nurses were nurses who were taking care of children with cancer. And many of them had been doing it for many years. And they talked about, His Holiness the Dalai Lama had been talking about how wonderful compassion is, how much energy it gives you, how in order to be effective, you don't need anger. Actually, compassion is a more effective power source to get things done. So compassion is this wonderful thing. And the more compassion you have, the better you feel, and the more you go in that direction, it sort of builds upon itself like a snowball. And these nurses who took care of these cancer children all kind of understood that, And they agreed with that to some extent. But then one of them said, you know, that's true, but I've been doing this for 10, 20 years or whatever. And I have to say there's another side of that, and that is, I don't think she used the term compassion burnout, but that's what she was talking about. It's really, really hard when it feels so great when you pour all your energy and resources into a child with cancer and you save them and you cure them. That's nothing more wonderful than that. Oftentimes that's not possible, but you give them another year or two of life. You ameliorate their suffering. You feel really good about that. You gave them another year or two, you lessen their suffering. You feel really good about that. But eventually that child dies. And you know it's inevitable. That, you know, that's probably going to happen 9 times out of 10 with the population we're serving. But it's still really hard when they die. But you let it go and you move on, you try to do more good, but you know, eventually there's a snowballing effect and you've lost so many of these that eventually you can't take it anymore. And so my experience is that compassion is not energizing, it's actually it's depleting. And His Holiness, you know, he heard all that and very compassionate, very sensitively, I can't say it the way he said it, but it might sound funny. He thought for about 2 seconds and he said, oh, that's attachment. And everybody, like in the audience, was just like, oh, of course. Nobody felt, and it wasn't like an offensive thing. It was like, oh, obviously. That, in other words, what these nurses were talking about was fully understandable. Any of us would probably feel that. But he was pointing out that's compassion mixed with attachment. It's not pure compassion. And in that one sort of statement, he was explaining, I thought, what compassion could be, what it should be, which is this objectless compassion. Free of attachment. Now, why is that objectless? It doesn't mean it would seem like it's cold, right? When we say objectless, it would seem like it's very cold, like I don't see you as a person. It's one thing to see you as a person and be attached to you and then therefore want, and I'm invested in your well-being. That actually makes compassion less effective from this point of view. What makes compassion super effective is when you can empty out the sense of you really are this person who's really suffering and your suffering is really real and by gosh, I gotta save you. There's a level on which suffering is suffering and it needs to be addressed, but there's another level on which it's a moment in time, your life's gonna go on. I mean, even suffering can teach lessons, et cetera. There's a way of, it's kind of a detachment, but not a cold detachment. It's a detachment that can completely continue to feel the pain, but not be attached to it, and not be attached to a specific kind of outcome. So it's a compassion that's infused with emptiness. There's actually a very famous verse in here, in Nagarjuna. It's actually in this text, but it's a famous verse quoted throughout all Mahayana texts. Let me see if I can find it real quickly. I lost it there, okay. I just wanted to find it here. I'm not sure if I, anyway, the phrase, I can quote the phrase. Nagarjuna talks about shunyata, the phrase in Sanskrit is shunyata karana garbham, very famous phrase in Mahayana Buddhism that comes from this text. Shunyata is emptiness, karana is compassion, garbham means, it can mean womb, it can mean seed, it can mean essence, it can mean a lot of things like that. And here, that's usually translated, it's a compound word, hyphenated, but it's usually translated as emptiness, the womb of compassion, or emptiness, the essence, whose essence is compassion. So again, where emptiness again sounds cold and sterile, like empty space, if we understand emptiness to mean interdependence, which is what it means, because emptiness means, or selflessness means, lack of independent, separate self. When that's lacking, what exists is interdependence. So since those are synonymous, it then makes sense that, oh, emptiness actually means compassion, and vice versa. And only to the extent to which I'm empty of myself, or let's put it this way, to the extent that I'm empty of myself, being separate from you, to the extent I'm able to be empty of myself, to that extent I'm actually able to be open and compassionate and really see you and feel you. So at the very, very highest level, objectless compassion is that kind of compassion. And if you add to that bodhicitta, which is the notion that in order to maximize that, you have to become a Buddha, then on the relative level, it means becoming a Buddha. And that actually is Buddha form. It's the Buddha body. The Buddha mind, on the mind side, the Buddha mind sees emptiness, transcends time, sees your future Buddhahood right now. because even past, present, and future are sort of like long and short. Past, present, future are interdependent notions. There's a way in which they even talk about Buddha's seeing sort of time as collapse as omnipresent or something like that. So there's a sense in which there's not this attached urgency because they can see the emptiness. So bodhicitta, awakened mind, is a mind which sees emptiness on the ultimate level. Ultimately, that's what they see. Relatively, they see relative suffering beings and they address it. So that's why ultimate bodhicitta and relative bodhicitta are kind of given those two, are described in that way. I hope that helps.
That helped a lot.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank goodness. How are we doing on time? Oh, good, we got some more time. Another 15 minutes or so.
Yeah, sorry, just trying to remember it. Okay, so when we're talking about interdependence, is it really possible to see how everything is connected without overcharging our minds? Or, I mean, I kind of try to do that, and it's just, I don't know, I just kind of stop when I do. It seems like I have to stop and think, or I have to just run and go.
Well, I mean, that might be one of these zone of proximal development things. I think it's one thing to see it intellectually, mm-hmm. and then it's another thing to see it personally or directly. And I would suggest that even to see it sort of cognitively, intellectually, is extremely difficult. It actually takes, they say it can take years, decades. I mean, studying Madhyamaka philosophy, which is the kind of philosophy that digs into this, normally takes quite a few years. So although initially it can be a sort of an obvious insight, like, well, of course, I suppose, once you get sort of past a certain thing, you can, of course, I guess it makes sense, everything's connected to everything. But what does that mean? What actually takes years to undo is the number of clever psychological or philosophical or intuitive ways in which we don't see things that way, actually. And to actually go and actually find each one of those ways and shine a spotlight on each one and actually go after and deconstruct it. The example they give in, this is what Vipassana meditation is, insight meditation, right? And Vipassana meditation, which tries to do this kind of analysis, which again can take years to do well, to do thoroughly. One example they give in Vipassana texts is exactly the flashlight idea. Like if you go into a hotel room in India and the hotel patron owner says, oh, no problem. There's no scorpions, no snakes under your bed. We've taken care of, you know, you're in an area of India where there's scorpions and snakes. They say, no problem, no snakes, no, nothing under the bed. Everything's, we take, it's all fine. Are you just gonna go and, oh, great. He told me so, that's cool. I'm gonna go lie in my bed and go to sleep now. Probably not. You're gonna probably say, thank you very much. I appreciate your effort. And then you're gonna take out your flashlight and you're gonna look under the bed and look under the pillows and look in the pillowcase in the closet. I mean, you're gonna make sure there's no snakes or scorpions under your bed or anywhere. And once you've looked in every corner and made sure, then you can sleep well. That, they actually give that example in Vipassana texts. So it's one thing to say, oh yeah, I get it, there's no self, everything's interconnected, that makes sense. But it's quite another thing to actually analyze and take that flashlight of your own intellect, really, and look in every corner of your mind and your psyche and try to find all the ways in which your ego actually is extremely, you find out if you do this long enough, is extremely skilled at hiding little pieces of the self, like here and there. So it takes a long time, but it's worth the effort. And the idea is that if you do it cognitively, if you do it intellectually, let me backtrack. What is considered by many, not all, but many Buddhist philosophers and practitioners to be a mistake is to think, who needs to do this cognitive, intellectual, philosophical stuff? Maybe it helps in the beginning for do that for a year. But then you get onto meditation and you can meditatively directly experience emptiness and that cuts to the chase. So why bother with all this philosophy? What many will argue why that's not effective, and I would agree from what I've seen, is it's actually precisely what you don't want to do. Precisely because on many of the reificatory habit patterns that we have, that reify a self and reify things, are happening on an instinctual level. And if you leave those intact, and if you meditate, what you can have is you can have a meditative experience that will be a manifestation of your indirect sense of self And if you have a meditative experience of that, you can actually corroborate that, and you can actually have confirmation that in some sense yourself exists in a certain kind of a way. There's all sorts of Buddhist meditative states and even God realms and so forth that they talk about that you can precisely manifest that are delusory. In other words, they're very, very, very critical and aware in Buddhist practices and texts that there's all sorts of experiences you can have that are delusory experiences. They're deluded. They're not real. They're projections or manifestations of your own unconscious patterns of wrong thinking. And because they're aware of that, they don't say, all you got to do is just meditate, watch your breath, sort of drop all your thoughts, and everything's going to be fine. They're actually extremely critical of precisely that kind of meditation. And the antidote is what? The antidote is you intellectually, philosophically first spend years showing that any kind of inherent or intrinsic existence is incoherent. And there's all sorts of philosophical systems to look at that. And to the extent to which you've undermined all of that, to that extent, you've not automatically taken away your instinctual habit patterns, but you've pulled the rug out from under them. You've kind of made them not able to really hide in the shadows, in a sense. So then if in meditation you have an experience of sort of cosmic oneness with the universe, of the great infinite self, of some, you recognize, wait a minute, that's got to be a construct. This cosmic sense of self, of me pervading, because there are all these meditative states of infinite space, infinite consciousness, infinite nothingness, infinite beyond consciousness and unconsciousness. These are well-known, the four form and formless realms, meditative states that the Buddha existed at the time of the Buddha. The Buddha had these experiences. Meditation teachers taught him an experience of infinite nothingness, of infinite space, of infinite consciousness. Right? Any Buddha life story you read about talks about how this is before he was the Buddha. He had these experiences, and he recognized these are amazing, these are wonderful trances. And they're even God realms. You can sort of die and be born in them and live there for billions of aeons, but they're not, they're still constructed states. Even a state of infinite nothingness or infinite consciousness is a constructed state, just like my sense of a separate self. So he saw through those. He saw that's not liberation. That's not enlightenment. That's not awakening. That's why his final insight into emptiness is very profound and very unusual, because it's not a description of any specific state. And different yogis at the time did say liberation is, enlightenment is, this experience of infinite space or infinite consciousness. They said that's liberation. We don't have the time to really fully unpack how and why the Buddha said that's not, but his insight is not that, no, yours is wrong, mine is right. He didn't come up with another something called emptiness, which he said, my experience of emptiness is right and your experience of space is wrong. The insight of emptiness is precisely the insight that any experience that you could possibly have is a construct. There's a radically deconstructive awareness. It's not an experience of something in and of itself. This is very, very strange. It's radically emptying. In another text, Nagarjuna says, emptiness is not a view. It's considered to be the cure to all dogmatic views. And therefore, anybody who holds emptiness to be a view is considered incurable. So it's not that that's a view, like my view against your view. It's a description of radical emptying. That's why it's called emptiness. This is radical. And what's strange is when you radically empty all possible subjective states as being the one thing that's real, what you don't end up with is nothing. Because I mentioned earlier, way earlier tonight, that existence and non-existence are two sides of one coin. So when you've seen through all possible somethings as being the final state of reality, and all of them you've seen through, the final thing you see through is the possibility that nothingness is the final state of reality. So somethingness and nothingness both go away, and you're back. It's the first is a mountain, then there is no mountain, then there is kind of thing. So all of relative reality comes back again, but this time thoroughly relative and not imbued with any intrinsic reality anywhere. So that's a long answer to say that this is why they consider the philosophical analysis part of it necessary. Mm-hmm. Not sufficient. It's not necessary and sufficient, but it's necessary. So years of philosophical study while simultaneously doing meditation, no problem, fine. Some people do all the philosophy first and then do the meditation. Some do them both simultaneously. But your meditation experience of perception of emptiness will, in a sense, only be as good or as accurate as you have philosophically knocked the legs out from under your habit patterns. So it's all zone of proximal development, to get back to your initial question. And it's something that takes years, and that's fine. It's what else are you going to do? From Nagarjuna's point of view, fine, it takes years, okay. Okay, get on with it, you know, be patient and do it. Both, the philosophy and then eventually the integration. The word bhavana, by the way, which is translated as meditation, really means realization or integration. It's the way in which you, it properly understood what meditation should mean, is it's a practice by which you make your subjective experience come in line with what you realize must be the case. You realize the world must be round and not flat, but you still perceive it as flat. So what practice can you do to make your perception actually come in the line with your conception, for example? Okay, so how are we doing on time? A couple more minutes. Any other thoughts, disagreements, questions? Yes.
So this question that you just answered, it brings another one. So say Buddha had this experience that he defined as emptiness, and he said that, well, there are four other experiences, and this one is, well, a complete liberation, if I got it right. So, but when we meditate and we have this, well, let's say empirical data, we always use theories to interpret this empirical data. So that's what you were talking about, that we need to do philosophical analysis. But when we have new theories and we have empirical data to back them up, then we evolve our theories and they demand more data, and more data demand more theories, and actually we can never have a complete theory. It's always just an approximation, a model. So how can we be sure that what the Buddha came up with is actually a liberation?
That is a perfect question. Question, excellent question. And the answer is precisely because he didn't come up with another model. That's what I was trying to suggest when I was saying it's not my experience of emptiness is better than your experience of nothingness or consciousness. It's precisely a non-model. And he'll actually say, and it's actually a little bit it's inappropriate to talk about experiencing emptiness. He had an experience of emptiness, like there's a self that experienced emptiness. If you have a self that's experiencing emptiness, there's already a problem. From this point of view. Even philosophically, we don't even talk about experience for a minute here, just talk about logically speaking, the two sides of the coin, sort of not, is there some aspect, like you could ask, I could ask the question, if it made sense to you, the two sides of the coin metaphor or analogy, that they're completely interdependent, right? If we start scraping off all the atoms of one side, at what point, so if I have a quarter of George Washington and an eagle, I start scraping off George Washington, George Washington goes away. So at some point you can say there's no longer a head side. I'm scraping off the eagle, now there's no longer a tail side. At least you can't recognize it as a heads and a tails because George and the eagle are gone, but at least there's an A and a B still. Maybe there's some distinguishing characteristic. Even if we can't distinguish them, we still say there's a thing that's facing the ceiling and one that's facing the floor. If we keep, in a thought experiment, keep shaving it down, at some point, at what point have we destroyed side A or the upside, let's say? I mean, let's say we bring it down to one molecule thick of metal atoms. But there's still an upside and a downside. At what point do we say we've destroyed the A side or the upside of the coin? I mean, we might have a problem just physically with molecular bonds and so forth, but at some point in the thought experiment, you can keep on going forever. And if you arbitrarily say at some point, okay, right now, when you've gone halfway into the nucleus of the atom, at that point, there's no longer an upside. At that point, is it not the case that simultaneously, not a nanosecond later, the B side is gone? Because the very notion of a side is they're interdependent. This is one side of that. You have an inside and an outside, or an upside and a downside. That kind of a reason I'm giving you that example again is to suggest that it wouldn't, if you understand that example, it wouldn't be appropriate to say, well, okay, but maybe if we gathered more data, we could somehow figure out that actually the two sides didn't disappear. This, you know, it's logically the case that the A side and the B side are totally interdependent. therefore, it's logically the case that the A side doesn't exist, at least not in the way that we normally posit existence, which is as independent. So A actually doesn't exist as a separate thing. Normally, we think of things existing separately, if that makes sense. So A exists only insofar as, or only in relation to, B. That's a negative insight. When I say A doesn't exist, that's a negative statement, right? I'm not positing anything. I'm not making a positive declaration now. I'm making only a negative. And that's an important aspect about the doctrine of emptiness, is it's only a negative statement. It's not positing anything positive whatsoever. And that's why it's not a question of it being a theory that sort of can go up against other theories. It's kind of a non-theory. What it is, it's the ultimate theory of that empties out all other theories. Or to be more a little more precise, it shows what you were saying earlier. It shows precisely the contingency of all theories. Everything you, any theory you want to come up with or model you want to come up with may be perfectly fine. It may be useful conventionally to operate on a patient's body or to fix a car or to send a rocket to the moon. And it's always a work in progress. You can always gather more data and refine the theory. And from a Buddhist point of view, exactly right. You can come up with as many theories as you want, models, and if they solve a particular problem, that's great. If another model solves it better or predicts an outcome even better, that's great. But no one of those models or theories ever could be, even logically, held to be the final model that kind of explains everything and is the one paradigm that is, you have to put it this way and then you've got it right. So from the Buddhist point of view, from the emptiness point of view, everything is always a model waiting to be disproven or it's contingent, it's relative. So it's a kind of, it's a meta-level theory, it's a theory about how everything else works. But what's important to understand about that, which usually when people first study it get mistaken, is they think that that means, oh, everything's relative and anything goes. It doesn't mean that. It also doesn't mean nothing exists. It actually affirms the relative existence of everything. Or what it does is rather it posits that any model you can come up with is relative. It's not that it doesn't exist. It's not that trees don't exist and watering the tree won't make the tree grow. It's just, what is your concept of what does water mean? What does it mean to grow? What is a tree exactly? Is a pine tree, a bush, I mean, et cetera. You know, we could sort of go on ad infinitum about that. But it actually opens up it opens up relative reality to being thoroughly investigated. And within the realm of relative reality then, the Buddha's discovery was nothing stays static ever. And therefore, actually things evolve and devolve. And why do they evolve and devolve? They don't just evolve and devolve randomly or for no reason. They're all causes and conditions. Everything else comes down to some, and causes and conditions are always also contingent. If you posit this caused that, that's a model. Nagarjuna in his book actually very interestingly deconstructs causes and effects and say you can't say anything causes anything because it's an arbitrary distinction of where do you say this caused that. So on an ultimate level, you can't say this causes that, but precisely on a relative level, you can say this germ causes that disease or whatever. And that then becomes what's the most interesting and important thing to look at is causation. And since everything's always evolving and changing on a relative level and you can come up with a model for causation and evolution, then on a relative level, that's what Buddhahood or waking up is all about. It's a relative waking up to this more and more, to seeing more and more of the interconnections, and in a sense being freer and freer of assuming any one model to be right. It's like maximum flexibility. It's like a jazz musician or somebody who knows their theory and is so well schooled in their scales and their modes and everything that on a particular chord progression they can instantly play scales and modes that are expected, or they can play outside the changes and do something unexpected, show other relationships between notes and chords that nobody ever thought of before. They're not constrained to a certain musical theory of what's supposed to be played, and it'll sound good. If they really good jazz musician like a Coltrane or a Miles Davis or somebody, they know how to do that because they're such masters. To be a master of the rules means actually to be able to be free of the rules, right? To be able to break them in really creative ways. So that's what a Buddha does. A Buddha knows the rules of relative causation so well that he or she or it is actually totally free. And actually that's another translation that's sometimes given for shunyata is freedom. It means emptiness, it means relativity, it means freedom. So I hope that, I would love it if you could take a semester-long class on this topic, because it does take a while to really unpack precisely what you're asking, but you put your finger right on an important point, which is emptiness is not just another theory. It's considered not a theory. Like I said before, Nagarjuna called it to be, said it was it's the cure to all theories. It's intended to be the antidote to all theories. And therefore, if you hold it to be a theory itself, you're in big trouble. In another quote, he says, as a famous quote, he said, a misunderstood emptiness is like a poorly grasped snake. In India, if there's a venomous snake, you better grab that snake right by the back of the head. If you grab it exactly right, then you're good. If you grab that snake in the wrong way, in the middle of the body, it whips around and bites you and kills you. And emptiness, if you exactly understand it, it's great. You can get the venom from the snake and turn it into medicine. If you grab it the wrong way, it bites you and it becomes nihilism. Poorly grasped snake, the metaphor here is that emptiness misunderstood or misgrasped becomes nihilistic. So that is a big danger, which is precisely why I don't think I read the verse tonight, did I? But there's a verse in here where Nagarjuna says, if somebody's not ready for it, you definitely don't teach them emptiness. It's just too dangerous. You teach them these kind of these ethics and compassion and so forth. And only once a person is at a level where it could actually be helpful to go to that next level, then you introduce emptiness. Because then it can supercharge compassion in the way we were talking about before. But prior to that, it actually is dangerous. So I hope that
thank you.
Is a good preliminary answer at least. Okay, so I think we should wrap up here. So I hope to see some of you at least when I'm back for the Nalanda talk in a month, and I know you have the Lama coming back next week and some other great talks before then, or after then. Thanks.